The Gramophone by Herman Charles Bosman. That was a terrible thing that happened with Christian Lemmer, Wim Skalglauren said. It was pretty bad for me, of course, but it was much worse for Christian. I remember well when it happened, for that was the time when the first gramophone came into the Mariku Boschveld. Christian bought the machine off a Jew trader from Pretoria. It's funny when you come to think of it. When there is anything that we Boers don't want, you can be quite sure that the Jew traders will bring it to us and that we'll buy it too. I remember how I laughed when a Jew came to my house once with a hollow piece of glass that had a lot of silver stuff in it. The Jew told me that the silver in the glass moved up and down to show you if it was hot or cold. Of course, I said, that was all nonsense. I know when it's cold enough for me to put on my woolen shirt and jacket without having first to go and look at that piece of glass. And I also know when it's too hot to work, which it is almost all the year round in this part of the Mariku Boschveld. In the end, I bought the thing. But it's never been the same since little Annie stirred her coffee with it. Anyway, if the Jew traders could bring us the miltsik, we would buy that off them as well, and pay them so much down, and the rest when all our cattle are dead. Therefore, when a trader brought Christian Lemmer a second-hand gramophone, Christian sold some sheep for many miles around the people came to hear the machine talk. Christian was very proud of his gramophone. And when he turned the handle and put in the little sharp pins, it was just like a child that has found something new to play with. The people who came to hear the gramophone said it was very wonderful what things a man would think of making when once the devil had got hold of him properly. They said that, if nothing else, the devil has got good brains. I also thought it was wonderful. Not that the gramophone could talk, but that people wanted to listen to it doing something that a child of 7 could do as well. Most of the songs the gramophone played were in English. But there was one song in Afrikaans. It was, "Oor Brandewyn Laat My Staan." Christian played that often. The man on the round plate sang it rather well. Only the way he pronounced the words made it seem as though he was a German trying to make "Oor Brandewyn Laat My Staan" sound English. It was just like the Rooineks, I thought. First they took our country and governed for us in a better way than we could do ourselves. Now they wanted to make improvements in our language for us. But if people spoke much about Christian Lemmer's gramophone, they spoke a great deal more about the unhappy way in which he and his wife lived together. Christian Lemmer was then about 35. He was a big, strongly built man, and when he moved about, you could see the muscles of his shoulders stand out under his shirt. He was also a surprisingly good-natured man, who seldom became annoyed about anything. Even with the big drought, when he had to pump water for his cattle all day and the pump broke so that he could get no water for his cattle, he just walked into the house and lit his pipe and said that it was the Lord's will. He said that perhaps it was as well that the pump broke, because if the Lord wanted the cattle to get water, he wouldn't have sent the drought. That was the kind of man Christian Lemmer was. And he would never have set hand to the pump again either, was it not that the next day rain fell, whereby Christian knew that the Lord meant him to understand that the drought was over. Yet, when anything angered him, he was bad. But the unfortunate part of Christian Lemmer was that he could not get on with his wife Susanna. Always they quarrelled. Susanna, as we knew, was a good deal younger than her husband, but often she didn't look so very much younger. She was small and fair. Her skin had not been much darkened by the Bushveld sun, for she always wore a very wide kapi, the folds of which she pinned down over the upper part of her face whenever she went out of the house. Her hair was the colour of the beard you see on the yellow mealies just after they have ripened. She had very quiet ways. In company, she hardly ever talked, unless it was to say that the Indian shopkeeper in the remotza put roasted crema tart roots with the coffee he sold us. Or that the spokes of the mule cart came loose if you didn't pour water over them. You see, what she said were things that everybody knew and that no one argued about. Even the Indian storekeeper didn't argue about the crema tart roots. He knew that was the best part of his coffee. And yet, although she was so quiet and unassuming, Susanna was always quarrelling with her husband. This, of course, was foolish of her, especially as Christian was a man with gentle ways until somebody purposely annoyed him. Then he was not quite so gentle. For instance, there was the time when the chief and the Torsa Kaffirs passed him in the veld and said good morning without taking the leopard skin off his head and calling Christian Baas. Christian was fined £10 by the magistrate and had to pay for the doctor during the 3 months that the Mtorsa chief walked with a stick. One day, I went to Christian Lemmer's farm to borrow a roll of baling wire for the teff. Christian had just left for the Krans to see if he could shoot a ribbok. Susanna was at home alone. I could see that she'd been crying, so I went and sat next to her on the Rimpie's bunk and took her hand. "Don't cry, Susanna," I said. "Everything will be all right. You must just learn to understand Christian a little better. He's not a bad fellow in his way." At first, she was angry with me for saying anything against Christian, and she told me to go home. But afterwards, she became more reasonable about it, allowing me to move up a bit closer to her and to hold her hand a little tighter. In that way, I comforted her. I would have comforted her even more, perhaps, only I couldn't be sure how long Christian would remain in the Krans. And I didn't like what happened to the Mtorsa Kaffir chief. I asked her to play the gramophone for me. Not because I wanted to hear it, but because you always pretend to take an interest in the things your friends like, especially when you borrow a roll of baling wire off them. When anybody visits me and gets my youngest son, Willy, to recite texts from the Bible, I know that before he leaves, he's going to ask me if I'll be using my millie planter this week. So Susanna put the round plate on the thing and turned the handle, and the gramophone played Oor Brannewyn Laat My Staan. You couldn't hear too well what the man was singing, but I've said all that before. Susanna laughed as she listened, and in that moment, somehow, she seemed very much younger than her husband. She looked very pretty, too. But I noticed also that when the music ended, it was as though she was crying. Then Christian came in. I left shortly afterwards, but I'd heard his footsteps coming up the path, so there was no need for me to leave in a hurry. But just before I went, Susanna brought in coffee. It was weak coffee, but I didn't say anything about it. I'm very much like an Englishman that way. It's what they call manners. When I'm visiting strangers and they give me bad coffee, I don't throw it out and say that the stuff isn't fit for a Kaffir. I just drink it and then don't go back to that house again. But Christian spoke about it. "Fro," he said, "the coffee is weak."
"Yes,"
Susanna answered. "It's very weak," he went on.
"Yes,"
she replied. "Why do you always," Christian began again.
"Oh, go to hell," Susanna said.
Then they went at it, swearing at one another, and they didn't even hear me when, on leaving, in the manner of the Bushveld, I said, "Goodbye, and may the good Lord bless us all." It was a dark night that time, about 3 months later, when I again went to Christian Lemmer's house by mule cart. I was leaving early in the morning for Zierist with a load of millies and wanted to borrow Christian's wagon sail. Before I was halfway to his house, it started raining. Big drops fell on my face. There was something queer about the sound of the wind in the wet trees. And when I drove through the poort where the government road skirts the line of the Dwarsberge, the place looked very dark to me. I thought of death and things like that. I thought of pale, strange ghosts that come upon you from behind, suddenly. I felt sorry then that I'd not brought the Kaffir along. It was not that I was afraid of being alone, but it would have been useful on the return to have a Kaffir sitting in the back of the mule cart to look after the wagon sail for me. The rain stopped. I came to the farm's graveyard, where had been buried members of the Lemmer family and of other families who'd lived there before the Lemmers, and I knew that I was near the house. It seemed to me to be a very silly sort of thing to make a graveyard so close to the road. There's no sense in that. Some people, for instance, who are ignorant or a bit superstitious are liable, perhaps, to start shivering a little, especially if the night is dark and there's a wind and the mule cart is bumpy. There were no lights in the Lemmer's house when I got there. I knocked for a long time before the door was open, and then it was Christian Lemmer standing in the doorway with a lantern held above his head. He looked agitated at first, until he saw who it was, and then he smiled. "Come in, Jef Schalk," he said. "I'm pleased you are here. I was beginning to feel lonely, you know, the rain and the wind. But you're not alone," I replied. "What about Susanna?" "Oh, Susanna has gone back to her mother," Christian answered. "She went yesterday." We went into the voorkamer and sat down. Christian Lemmer lit the candle and we talked and smoked. The window panes looked black against the night. The wind blew noisily through openings between the wall and the thatched roof. The candle flame flickered unsteadily. It could not be pleasant for Christian Lemmer alone in that house without his wife. He looked restless and uncomfortable. I tried to make a joke about it. "What's the matter with you, Christian?" I asked. "You're looking so unhappy. Anybody would think you still got your wife here with you." Christian laughed, and I wished he hadn't. His laughter did not sound natural. It was too loud. Somehow, I got a cold kind of feeling in my blood. It was a rather frightening thing, the wind blowing incessantly outside the house, and inside the house a man laughing too loudly. "Let's play the gramophone, Christian," I said. By that time I knew how to work the thing myself, so I put in one of the little pins and started it off. But before doing that, I had taken the gramophone off its table and placed it on the floor in front of my chair, where I could get at it more easily. It seemed different without Susanna's being there. Also, it looked peculiar to me that she should leave so suddenly. And there was no doubt about it that Christian was acting in a strange way that I didn't like. He was restless. When he lit his pipe, he had to strike quite a number of matches. And all the time round the house, the wind blew very loudly. The gramophone began to play. The plate was "Oor Brannewyn, Laat Mij Staan." I thought of Susanna and of the way she had listened 3 months before to that same song. I glanced up quickly at Christian, and as soon as he caught my eye, looked away. I was glad when the gramophone finished playing, and there was something about Christian that made me feel that he was pleased also. He seemed very queer about Susanna. Then an awful thought occurred to me. You know, sometimes you get a thought like that and you know that it is true. I got up unsteadily and took my hat. I saw that all around the place where the gramophone stood, the dung floor of the voorkamer had been loosened and then stamped down again. The candle threw flickering shadows over the floor and over the clods of loose earth that had not been stamped down properly. I drove back without the buck sail.